Now, another story about medicine, this of a shocking experiment and a tainted legacy. Ray Suarez gets the details.
The medical experiments were conducted in Guatemala more than six decades ago, but did not come to public light until this past weekend. Between 1946 and 1948, researchers with the U.S. Public Health Service deliberately infected nearly 700 Guatemalans with syphilis, in most cases without their knowledge, in an effort to determine whether penicillin could prevent the disease. The U.S. government apologized for the experiments on Friday. Wellesley College professor Susan Reverby uncovered the documents while she was researching a book about another shameful chapter, the Tuskegee experiments. She joins us now with more on her findings. Professor Reverby, what were American doctors doing in Central America in 1946, and what were they doing to their subjects?
They were trying to figure out whether penicillin could be used to treat people before their syphilis infection took hold and had been already measured. So if you think about it, it's a little bit like the morning after pill, which you take when you think you've had unprotected sex and don't want to get pregnant. They were trying to figure out whether penicillin would work for syphilis. But they needed a pool of infection. And rather—so they went to Guatemala because prostitution was legal in Guatemala, and it was also legal to take a prostitute into a prison for sexual services for prisoners.
So they were using prisoners as basically their stock of observed subjects?
Right. They started off doing prisoners, and when not enough infection was created with the prostitutes, they moved on to actually giving the men syphilis itself, and because they needed a larger pool of subjects, they moved on to an army barracks and then to the National Insane Asylum.
With the cooperation of the Guatemalan government of the time?
Well, the cooperation of a man named Juan Funes, who was the director of the sexually transmitted diseases in the Guatemalan Public Health Department. So how far up it went, but obviously Americans can't just walk into a prison or even an army barracks in Guatemala, even in 1946. So clearly the heads of all of those institutions had to give permission.
As we mentioned earlier, you were doing more scholarly work about the Tuskegee program. How did that lead you to Guatemala?
I was in the archives at the University of Pittsburgh looking at the papers of Thomas Perrin, who had been the Surgeon General when the Tuskegee study was first going on. And I found, while I was there, the papers of John Cutler, who had worked in Tuskegee in the 60s. And I opened the box expecting to find more on Tuskegee, and there was nothing on Tuskegee in the box. But in fact, all there was in the box was this material on the Guatemala study. And it said very clearly, inoculation syphilis. And I was completely floored by what was there. I just had no expectation and no way of knowing what would be there because it had never been published.
So Dr. Cutler was the link between these two programs, but there's a difference with Tuskegee, isn't there?
That's right, absolutely. And that was part of what interested me. I've spent two decades writing about Tuskegee. I've written two books on it. And the differences are very clear. In Tuskegee, the men already had latent syphilis, even though there's a myth that they were infected by the government. They were not. In Guatemala, they absolutely infected all of these people. In Tuskegee, the idea was to deny treatment as much as possible to the men. In the Guatemala study, almost all of these people were treated. What we're now looking at is the medical records determine whether everybody got enough, and it looks like maybe about a third of the people there did not really get cured once they'd been infected by the United States government.
In the 1940s, were the rules governing experimentation in humans very different from what they are today? Did the people involved from the United States think they were doing something wrong?
Well, first of all, there were really no rules. I mean, there were expectations and sort of a sense of what was right, but there were no regulations the way we have them now and have had them since the mid-1970s. And second of all, this study was enough on the edge that what I found in the correspondence, which is frankly one of the more shocking things, was the language back and forth where it became really clear that they knew that this was improper, and Cutler's bosses were not sure. And there's an amazing quote from Perrin, the Surgeon General, who says, look, we couldn't do this in the United States.
So beyond the difference between the two countries, was there also anything latent about the way they thought about Guatemalans compared to what they would have thought about Americans in a similar setting?
Well, they actually, you know, understood that there was a racial difference in the disease. They thought that African Americans and white people had a different kind of syphilis, and they certainly thought that was a similar problem in Guatemala. But I think they really went to Guatemala because of the connection with Funes and because they could get easily to this access of these prisoners. And a lot of American research in this time period was also being done in prison populations.
Well, since the story broke, since you broke it, it's been called shocking, improper, many other similar names. But did it turn up anything worth knowing, ultimately?
No. I mean, what's interesting is that Cutler never published anything. They really couldn't create enough infection to really get any interesting results. And by 1948, it became really clear that penicillin could cure syphilis really easily. And so there was less interest from Washington to really continue this kind of research. And so they had him pack up and come home. I think the thing that's interesting here, both with this and with Tuskegee, is in the end, it teaches us more about the doing of medical research than it does about medical science per se.
It turned out that it's much harder to give people syphilis than you might have thought it was, doesn't it?
Well, I knew it wasn't. That's why it's a sexually transmitted disease. So all those warnings about dirty toilet seats, you know, are myths. It is a disease that has to be in moisture. It can't be created in a cell line, even now. It has to be transmitted through sexual contact, through an infectious mother to her child only at birth, or through breast milk.
But even sending prostitutes into the prisons of Guatemala wasn't a reliable method of transmission, was it?
No, it wasn't. That's why I called my paper normal exposure, because they kept saying, look, it's not working with normal exposure. So that's when they moved to this system of trying to abrade these men and women's hands, and then their on their cheeks, and then with the men actually on their genitalia, and to pour the inoculum on them. And it required them to literally pull back the man's, you know, front of his penis, to hold a cotton pledgelet with the inoculum in place for an hour and a half to 2 hours. So as you can imagine, not everybody let them do this. Prisoners ran away. It wasn't so easy to do. And the study just really didn't work.
Professor Reverby, thanks for joining us.
You're welcome. Thank you for asking me.